Electricians can find it a daunting prospect when asked to size a solar panel array for a customer. But should we be daunted? Well, the answer to that question is no. And in this video, I'll be taking you through the process of how we calculate the self-consumption of a solar array for an installation. And if you didn't know, this video is one of a series of videos that we have made in association with SunSync on the installation of a solar system. They can be viewed individually, or you can click the link in the description below to view them as part of a free online training package to help you with your CPD and receive a certificate to prove you've completed the course. So what are the factors and limitations that impact a solar and storage system? Well, let's look at them. Our biggest limitation is the space we have to put the panels in. Panels can just about go anywhere they can fit, as long as they have good access to the sunshine, which is why roof spaces are ideal locations, as they are normally above anything that can cast a shadow. But with roof-mounted systems, we do need to consider the wind and additional loads to the roof. Section 11.3 of the IET Code of Practice for grid-connected solar photovoltaic systems gives guidance on this and some example wind load calculations. Equally, we also need to consider the additional weight which needs to be added to the roof, including if snow was to be on the panels. You may even need to obtain a structural survey, but this falls out the scope of this CPD. But for reasons we'll look at in a moment, roofs may not be suitable. So where else could we install them? Well, if your garden is big enough, a ground-mounted array is an option, as well as flat roofs, making sure that the panels are fitted securely by either fixings or ballast to stop them from blowing away. Panels can even be mounted on walls, like the ones shown here at the Lincoln Medical School. If the space is available, we can put panels there. Our next factor is the orientation that the panels will be facing. Our sun sits in a southern sky, so a PV array which points that way is ideal. However, it's not always possible, as some roofs just don't point south. But is it still worth making the investment in solar panels, even if the orientation is perhaps east or west? We may not generate as much energy with an easterly or westerly roof, but we will still generate, and the amount we do generate may surprise you. We will look at how orientation can impact our solar generation later in the video. Another factor we are unable to control when fitting onto a sloping roof is the pitch, or the angle that the panels will sit at. The pitch matters, as the angle of sunlight hitting the PV array needs to be such so it will react with the semiconductive material of the panel to generate the most energy. But what is the most ideal angle or pitch? Well, in the UK, it's between 35 to 40 degrees, and this is because of the latitude the UK sits at and the angle the sun will hit the panels. But what if we can't get the ideal angle? Well, we can use this irradiance dataset available as a free download from the MCS website. We can see at 40 degrees pitch with 0 degrees to the south offers an irradiance number of 985, and the higher the number, the better the irradiance. If we keep the pitch at 40 degrees and move to an easterly orientation, we get an irradiance of 768. But if we decrease the angle of the pitch, we can increase the solar irradiance, because the shallower the panels are, the more solar will fall on them. If the pitch is not ideal, then another solution to improve the output of the PV array would be to add more panels, but only if we have the space to do this. The panels mounted here are at 90 degrees, which, according to the chart, is not ideal. However, as there are so many, it does offset the cost of the PV array. One factor we cannot do anything about is the seasons and the weather. We can estimate how the changing seasons are going to impact our PV installation. Starting in the summer, when the sun is at its highest in the sky, we can anticipate that more sunlight will hit our panels and for longer, due to the longer days. In the winter months though, as the sun hangs lower in the sky, we can expect a lower energy yield. The days are shorter and the weather tends to be more miserable, so we can also anticipate the potential energy that we'll get from the panels. In fact, the MCS has created a document which illustrates different parts of the UK and the expected sunshine or solar irradiance that they will expect. As you may have guessed, places like Cornwall and Devon, or coastal locations, tend to get more sun, so have a higher irradiance number. But looking at locations like Yorkshire and the Lake District, known for its overcast weather and wet days by many a hiker, the irradiance is lower, which will affect the amount of energy generated by a solar array. This doesn't mean though that because we live in the Highlands of Scotland, we should avoid fitting solar panels. In fact, location, although an impact, is not the biggest when it comes to the time of year. This impact is shading. Now, it may seem obvious that if a shade is cast on a solar panel, it's going to generate less energy. But shading is one of the factors which is overlooked most commonly, as shading on just half a panel can affect the entire solar array. Starting with near shading, this can be things like chimney stacks, TV aerials, or satellite dishes. It may be difficult to remove a chimney stack to stop shading, but could the panels be located in a way to avoid the stack casting a shadow? Where we have aerials, can these be relocated to an area where it won't cast a shadow? Plus, it is now seen as bad practice to have an aerial mounted on a chimney stack. Far shading is something we can't do a lot about and can happen at different times of the year. This is due to where the sun is in the sky. The MCS gives us a procedure that we can follow, the MGD-005 shade analysis form. So for our installation, I'm going to use a sun path chart and an app on my iPad. I need to position myself roughly in the middle of the ray and as high up as possible. This could be a bedroom window or scaffolding. Not ladders though, as you won't have the points of contact. Check out Joe CPD on working at heights. I can then move across the horizon, taking pictures as I go to transfer onto the sun path chart. The sun path chart has 84 segments, with each at a value of 0.01. And by marking objects on the horizon according to the height in relation to the proposed array, we'll count towards the shade factor. Once we have counted all of our shaded sections, this will give us the percentage factor that we can use on our overall calculation for the PV array. Now that we have considered the factors that impact a solar PV installation, we are now going to calculate the self-consumption of our four-bedroom property. We are required to provide this under the MCS Solar Standard Guide Section 4, which outlines the pre-sale information we must provide to the customer before they commit to the work taking place. So, starting with space. Using guidance from the IET Code of Practice for PV installations and confirming all the load factors and roof margins, which do fall outside the scope of this CPD, we can fit a total of 10 panels to our roof. A typical solar panel on its own can produce around 450 watts, so 10 of these will give us a PV array capable of generating 4.5 kilowatts. This, though, is under ideal circumstances, so we call this number the kilowatt peak. This is the maximum it can get to. So I'm going to bring up table 6.1 from the MCS self-consumption guide. This is where we will be inputting all of the data of our solar array. I have removed the parts relating to battery storage, as we're going to look at those in our next video. So looking at table 6.1, we have to determine the occupancy archetypes first. And this is given on table 4.1, where we have home all day, in half the day, out all day, and occupancy unknown. If you remember from our first video, I mentioned that knowing this was important, and this is why. Our customers are in for half of the day, so that's what we're going to put in the table here. Next, we need to know what the annual consumption of the property is, and from the smart data report from the previous video, we can see that the customer has an annual consumption of 4,382 kilowatt hour. We need to find our lookup tables which have self-consumption data in them. And for this, we use the annual consumption and property archetype to navigate to the correct table. Scrolling through, we come to table 7-15, which is in half the day and a consumption range of 4,000 to 4,499 kilowatt hour. So this is the table we're going to be using to calculate our self-consumption. Calculating the annual electrical generation from the PV array brings us back to the three main factors we looked at earlier: orientation, pitch, and shading. The MCS document, MIS 3002 in Appendix B, gives us a performance estimation method that we can follow. And by standardizing this process, it makes it easier for solar installers to give their customers the pre-sale information about the solar PV system. The process is: 1. Work out the rating of the PV array in kilowatts peak. 2. Ascertain the postcode region. 3. Determine the pitch of the array. 4. Determine the orientation of the array. And 5. Any shading. Remember, these are going to be estimated figures, and it's important we inform the customer of this. Okay, let's work this out, and we'll bring up our table here and the formula for calculating the annual estimate output of our panels. Our first term is the kilowatt peak. This is the data plate value of the panels and can be found on the modules. Now we have 10 450 watt module. So our kilowatt peak is 4.5 kilowatts. Our next term is KK. This relates to the location that our PV array will be located in the country. As mentioned earlier, southern counties and coastal locations tend to get more sun, so their levels of irradiance is going to be higher. KK also relates to the pitch and the orientation of the solar array. Our solar array is located in the East Midlands with a postal code of NG, which falls in Region 11 on Figure 1 of Table 2. Our roof has an incline of 30 degrees and is orientated south-southwest. The MCS irradiance datasets, which are a free download off the MCS website, list all the irradiance data of the regions located in the UK. We need to navigate to Region 11 in the tabs, and using the pitch and orientation degree, we can zero in on the average irradiance of our location. We have a pitch of 30 degrees and an orientation from south of 10 degrees. So our irradiance is 883 kilowatt hour. Next is the shading factor. Having completed the MCS MGD005 shade analysis form that we looked at earlier, I can see that I don't have any shading on our roof. So we have a shading factor of 1. Now we have got together all of the components of our formula here, we can now calculate the annual AC output of the installation. This comes out at 3,974 kilowatt hours. And this number goes into our table here. Back to the worked example, we can input the AC output range from table 7-15, which is for us 3,900 to 4,199 kilowatt hours. We can now move across this row to the PV only, and we can see that our percentage self-consumption is 25%. Multiplying the percentage into our AC output from the panels gives us our self-consumption for the installation, which is 994 kilowatt hours. Finally, if we divide that self-consumption into our total annual consumption, this will show us our independence from grid electricity. For example, for an average consumption from the previous video being 12 kilowatt hours a day, if we have a grid independence of 20%, that means we reduce our grid consumption to 9.6 kilowatt hours. Worth remembering though, this is an average over the year, and although it sounds low, as explained earlier in our previous video, we expect to use less energy and generate more energy in the summer than in the winter months. Our installation with the calculation shown here gives us a grid independence of 23%, which we can put into the table here. Now, there is software out there that can do all of this for you, but I do think it's good practice sometimes to go back to pencil and paper and calculate these like we did back in 2007. But what would happen to our installation if we had different factors like roof orientation, pitch, or shading? Well, we can look at that here. Let's say our roof was 90 degrees off south, so east. Our KK value from the irradiance data set, which is now 721 kilowatt hours. We can see that the self-consumption falls to 3,245 kilowatt hours. That's a decrease of over 700 kilowatt hours over the year. But is there anything we could do to make this better? Well, if there's space, we could throw on another couple of panels. Maybe the customer has a small hipped roof on their property, like this property here, which has a small south-facing roof, but they've utilized eastern and western elevations to increase their generation. Just adding two extra panels onto this orientation comes out at 3,966 kilowatt hours. Moving back to our south orientation and looking at the pitch of the panels can also make a difference. It is a rule that a panel on its back is better than a panel on its side, and the numbers support this, with a panel at 0 degrees coming out at 3,000 kilowatt hour, where the same array mounted at 90 degrees gives us a self-consumption of 2,563 kilowatt hours per annum. But it again may be worth mounting panels on a vertical surface if you have the space. These panels at the Lincoln Medical School face south, and the quantity of them could give an estimated self-consumption of 13,333 kilowatt hours per annum, which will go some way in increasing their independence from the grid. Finally, I'm going to subject our installation to a worst case scenario. We have an orientation of 175 degrees from south, a pitch of 40 degrees, and following our shading survey, a percentile of 0.11. Our 10 panel array with these numbers in the formula is shown to come out at 4,500 multiplied by 464 multiplied by 0.11, which gives us 204 kilowatt hours per annum self-consumption and a grid independence of 5%. Now in this scenario, it may not be worth it, but we will look at the same example later in our videos to see if there's anything else we could do to improve this self-consumption of this scenario. So let's recap our installation and the numbers from our worked example. Our property, with the homeowners being in half the day, consume 4,382 kilowatt hours per annum. We can fit 10 panels onto the roof, which gives us a peak generation of 4.5 kilowatt peak. The total annual generation we can expect from our solar array 10 degrees off south with a 30 degree pitch is 3,974 kilowatt hours with a grid independence of 23%. If you want to learn more about solar arrays and battery storage, you can click this link in the description below to watch it as part of our free training package to help you with your CPD and receive a certificate to prove you've completed the course. But until then, it's bye-bye for now.